Columbia Center Rotarians and guests, today we have the unique opportunity to have as our topic for our meeting the Hanford Waste Treatment Plant. So please give a warm, hearty Rotary welcome to Peggy McCullough.
Thank you so much, Don, and thank you for allowing me to come here today and talk about the important mission that we in the Department of Energy are trying to accomplish here at Hanford. Just a little bit more about me. I'm 27 years with Bechtel, and in addition to Yucca Mountain, which Don mentioned, my project assignments and responsibilities also included the fissile material storage facility in Mayak, Russia, and the stabilization and new safe confinement at Chernobyl. Just 30 seconds about Bechtel. Probably many people know about Bechtel, but in case you don't, we are a privately held engineering, procurement, and construction company. We operate globally with four business units: nuclear, security, and environment. That's where this project resides. Oil, gas, and chemicals, mining and metals, and infrastructure. And we've been the Department of Energy's contractor for the waste treatment plant since 2001. Many of you, of course, will have seen this graphic of the Hanford site. What's important there is the location of the WTP complex of facilities is located adjacent to the tank farms that contain the waste that we're going to be processing at the Vit Plant. Just a little bit of history. Hanford played a crucial role in both World War II and continuing on through the Cold War. And as a result of that, the complex of facilities that were built and the waste that were produced, that really by the mid-1960s, the government had constructed 9 reactors and all of the necessary support facilities. And with the close of the Cold War, and actually the rise of the demilitarization projects that Don mentioned, that really signaled the need for beginning to clean up the Hanford site. Now, Hanford was the largest of the 3 defense production sites in the U.S., and over that 40-year span of its operation, it was used to produce 64 metric tons of plutonium, and that was the Manhattan Project, and that helped end World War II, and continued on for military defense efforts during the Cold War. Now, the Department of Energy has made tremendous strides in cleaning up remnants of the plutonium production area, thousands of contaminated buildings and waste sites. We, along with other companies, were involved in that effort, Bechtel Hanford, cocooning reactors, demolishing burial sites, groundwater treatment. But the bulk of the remaining waste is in the 56 million gallons of liquid radioactive waste that sits in 177 underground tanks in that tank farm. So constituents in that tanks, sludge, salt cake, liquids, all containing about 190 million curies of radioactivity. Now, about 60 of those 177 tanks are presumed to have leaked up to 1 million gallons of liquid radioactive waste into the soil. And so that waste has reached the groundwater under the Hanford site, but not yet the Columbia River, which is about 7 miles from the tank farm. So clearly, treating this waste, getting it into a stable form where it can't get into the groundwater, is really a priority for the Department of Energy and, of course, for this community. Just a little bit about the environment that the project operates in. You heard a little bit about my experience, so I've been involved in a number of nuclear jobs and a number of major construction efforts. But I would definitely tell you that this project receives the most oversight, certainly that I'm aware of in my career. And I think if I had many of my Bechtel colleagues up here, they would testify to that as well. The Department of Energy is our customer and the owner of the facilities. The Washington State Department of Ecology is the primary regulator here locally, along with the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. Now, the cleanup at Hanford is governed by the tri-party agreement. Those parties are the Department of Energy, the Department of Ecology, and the EPA. In addition, the Defense Nuclear Facilities Safety Board provides oversight of the Department of Energy with a congressional mandate. And I can honestly say we get a fair amount of inspection and scrutiny from Congress, and I also have to say that our representation here in the state of Washington to get funding for this cleanup is really outstanding. We couldn't ask for better support from our elected officials. They and their staff really do an amazing job for us. So I'm here today representing nearly 3,000 professionals, Bechtel and URS AECOM professionals at the Vit Plant. And also part of our team are hundreds of suppliers and subcontractors accomplishing this work. You can see on this slide that since the contract inception, nearly $1.2 billion of business has gone to Tri-City businesses for the Vit Plant. And just to name a few, not a comprehensive list, but local businesses or businesses with a significant local presence: Abadan, Dade Moeller, Horizon Distribution, Energy Solutions, Builders Hardware and Supply, Central Premix Concrete, Columbia Rigging, Oxarc, Lucas Engineering, H.D. Fowler, Intermec, Milne Tools, and Stoneway Electric. Now, all of this external scrutiny does for us is allows us to be completely transparent with what we're doing out at the waste treatment plant, and that's our desire. We want the community to know what's happening, but this is also one of the biggest challenges that we have, because at any given time, we can have as many as 40 external audits, surveillances, investigations going on, you know, with the project team. And so you can imagine that that's a challenge as you're trying to complete the work, as well as support these external parties that are auditing and surveilling us. Now, some of these can be quite simple. They can be time card checks out on the floor, but some can be pretty lengthy and pretty intrusive. And so trying to find the right balance and continue the work with that sort of an oversight load is a challenge for us, and it's a challenge for the Department of Energy as well, because many of these agencies, they don't work for the department. Now, the site itself, it's a complex of facilities, four major facilities on site. WTP is designed to be a batch plant process, and so there's an analytical laboratory where samples of those batches are sent. There is an upstream facility pretreatment that separates the waste stream into the most highly radioactive and then the low activity waste. Then those streams go on to subsequent facilities where they are vitrified. Their glass formers are added to the waste. They go into melters, and then we pour them into glass logs. So what we're really doing is we're concentrating and solidifying that waste so it cannot migrate anywhere. Now, just shortly after I arrived in 2013, the Department of Energy announced a revised approach for completing the waste treatment plant. Previously, the plan had been to progress all three facilities simultaneously, commission them all simultaneously. And I think in the face of the funding realities, the department made a decision to put the emphasis on completing the LAW facility and feeding it directly from the tank farms. So, I'm not going to go through this process flow diagram because I don't want to bore you, but we supported the plan because we thought it was achievable given the likely funding that the project would receive, and it also allowed us to start up one facility and embed the learning from that facility into the operations of the other facilities. Now, direct feed law does involve the construction of a facility on the tank farm side to actually remove cesium and solids, which can't be processed by low-activity waste from that waste stream. The effluent that comes from LAW will be managed in a new facility constructed at the WTP site, the effluent management facility. This allows the treatment of the waste from the tanks to begin as soon as possible, and it'll allow us to get significant operational experience in treating actually the largest volume of the waste, as well as the lowest radioactivity levels. So just a little bit about some of the accomplishments in 2015. Construction is largely completed in the analytical laboratory. The few remaining components to go in there, we're waiting because we're concerned about obsolescence. Completed placement and insulating materials in the two 300-ton LAW glass melters. So vitrification is a proven technology. There's a vitrification plant at Savannah River. There are some in the UK. What's unique about these LAW melters is they are the largest in the world. And the reason that they are the largest is because of the volume of waste that they have to process. So in order to process the volume of waste at Hanford, for example, and the vitrification facilities at Sellafield, would take over 2,000 years. So these melters have to be big because they have to process a lot of waste. That new facility that I mentioned, the effluent management facility, we're 30% complete on design of that. Construction continues on the high-level waste facility with 22 concrete placements. Those are walls and slabs in 2015. And we completed the testing of the control system used to mix waste in the large vessels. We mix waste using something called pulse jet mixers. And so this was the control systems testing for those pulse jet mixers. Looking forward to 2016. As I mentioned, the focus is on completing the lab, the low activity waste facility, and the infrastructure to support direct feed of LAW. Actually, work has already begun on the effluent management facility. And we are working very closely with the department and with the tank farm contractor, WRPS, to integrate the work for the ORP mission so that when we have the LAW facility complete, the tank farms is ready to send it to us. So we have become very integrated at this point in time. Now, the high-level waste facility and the pretreatment facility, the Department of Energy has sought a more robust basis underpinning the design for both of those, so that has resulted in what I would call a slowdown of activity. But we're looking to get back into full design, procurement, and construction on both HLW and pretreat. I would also add that, you know, we Bechtel, we have been a part of this community for a very long time. That predates the waste treatment plant with Bechtel Hanford. And those 3,000 employees that I mentioned are proud to live in this community. They're generous that between the corporate and the individual contributions made by Vit Plant employees in 2015 was nearly $700,000. And I can honestly say, in my 27 years with Bechtel, I've never witnessed an employee population that was so involved in the community, so committed to the community, and so willing to help. It's really thrilling to be a part of this team. Thank you so much.